How do you maximize Social Security? There's so much talk about it. Are there steps that a person can take to actually maximize their benefit?
Yeah, I think you can. Social Security has so many different ways that you can take things. And especially as a married couple, there's a lot of options for you. They changed the rules in 2015. There were a lot more loopholes at that point, but there's still some options that can really help you. You know, I think one of the things you need to look at is like, how long are you going to live? That's one of the biggest things. You know, realistically, you need to look at what your health is and think about that. Because if you're going to live a really long time, you want to push off taking Social Security as long as you can to maximize that benefit.
Hi, my name is Annette Bau, your host of the Wealth Inside and Out podcast. I'm a certified financial planner and founder of the Millionaire Insider. For over 30 years, I have been advising and researching the top 1% of millionaires, and I am passionately obsessed with money, mindset, and the intersection of self-worth and net worth, and how the two connect and allow us to live fulfilled and wealthy lives on our terms. I'm a Midwestern girl who had a dream, began investing $25 a month 35 years ago, and today have a multi-million dollar net worth. I teach the tried and true that only someone with over 3 decades of experience advising millionaires would know. This podcast is different, about much more than money. We talk about mindset, success, money blocks, worth barometer, and all aspects of money and topics from practical manifestation, along with real-world how-to, and everything in between, with the goal of making your journey easier and more fun. Think of this as coffee, actually matcha tea, learning real-world common sense money and life advice from a BFF that you can start applying today. If you want to create a financially free life you love, you are in the right place, my friend. This is the Wealth Inside and Out podcast. So today we're diving into maximizing your Social Security benefit. And you're basically learned the A to Z's of what you need to know about Social Security so that you have the best benefit you can, as well as when you take it. You're also going to learn what to do if you have been married or if you get remarried and all the different ramifications. There are so many critical factors when you start getting ready to plan for your Social Security. And a lot of people make mistakes by just making a rash decision. And I've seen people lose $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 because they have not properly planned for their Social Security. So don't let that be you. You're going to love today's episode. And Susan is just great. She's one of my advisors, one of my certified advisors, and she really knows the A to Z about Social Security. She gives a ton of resources. So stay tuned. You're going to love today's episode. The information we provide is not intended to replace any investment, financial, tax, or any other advice. Before beginning, please consult with your own team of advisors and review your situation.
For today's show notes, you can go to themillionaireinsider.com/7. For all episodes, go to themillionaireinsider.com/podcast.
So today's bonus resource is our retirement plan checklist. You can go to themillionaireinsider.com/RPC for retirement plan checklist. You're going to love this free resource because it provides you an overview of the actions you need to take to avoid worrying about running out of money. And it's going to help you to ensure you're going to live your life and retirement on your terms. We share insights in this free retirement planning checklist resource that many people don't even think about. So again, you can go to themillionaireinsider.com/RPC to access it. One of the biggest concerns women have is becoming a bag lady. This guide was specifically designed to provide you the first step to help you create a plan so you can stop worrying about running out of money. Again, themillionaireinsider.com/RPC. You're going to love this resource. I'm so excited to welcome you to Maximizing Social Security with Susan Kroger. She's not only a certified financial planner, but also a certified divorce financial analyst. And she specializes in working with women in transition who have been widowed, divorced, or going through a divorce. She helps educate them on their options so that they're confident in their financial decisions that they're making for themselves and their families. She enjoys both educating as well as helping people handle the finances and plan for the unexpected. I've known Susan for several years, probably, boy, what is it? 7, 8, 9 years, a long time. She's amazing.
and you are going to love her. So let's dive into the interview and you can meet Susan for yourself. So hi, Susan, and welcome. It's great to have you here.
Yeah, I'm really excited about being here today.
Oh, you're going to do great. So I'm so excited to learn from you. So we're talking about maximizing Social Security, and this is such a hot topic. I have had clients who literally have just gone and made decisions on Social Security without me even knowing. Like, we've talked about how important it is to have a plan about Social Security, and they're like, oh, I just decided to do it. Sometimes it's even like I talked to my CPA and I just went and did it. I'm like, what? Like, oh my gosh, that's a really important decision. And in some of the cases, like I can think of three different cases. One, because of what the people did, they lost like $30,000. And that case was because one of the parents was a lot older and they had minor children. They could have been collecting. And when you calculate how much they could have collected over a period of time, I mean, it's like, hands down, you know, it made sense. That was one. Another one was how they took their benefit, meaning from a perspective of when they started. And the third one had to do with divorce and somebody that just didn't realize what their options were. So this is so timely. And anyone that's not concerned about Social Security planning and really their retirement planning, I just say, oh, you guys, you got to wake up. This is probably the most important key to not only achieving financial freedom, but to be enjoying your retirement.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, even when people have assets, having Social Security and knowing they've got something coming in every month gives people some peace of mind, because your assets go up and down. And typically, you know, any sort of guaranteed income you can have just puts you more at peace.
Yeah, no, amen. So for some people, it can be overwhelming, right? And I don't feel like I'm really even an expert at Social Security planning, but where do you even start? Like, what would you say? Somebody's going, oh, should I be concerned about this? Or, oh, I've been thinking about this. Where should they start? And what should they do first?
Well, I think one of the most important things is for people to really understand, what does their Social Security situation look like? Otherwise, a lot of people will say, well, I'm going to take it at 62 because, you know, maybe it's going to go broke or something like that. But it's really important for you to go to ssa.gov. And you can download your most recent statement. And it's interesting because they have so much more information on the statements than they used to. It's also go to look and see, are your earnings records, is it accurate or not? People do make mistakes in the reporting. So if you're missing earnings on there, it's going to lower your Social Security. So it's important to take a look at that. And then what a lot of people don't realize is that Social Security looks at your last 35 years and kind of averages that out for what you have. So if you've worked 40 years, your last 5 years that you probably earned more is going to count more for you. So it's just something to take into consideration when you're looking at those numbers. Social Security website also has a lot of good calculators that you can use to see what happens when you do those estimations.
So just so I'm clear, so if, say, for instance, somebody has worked for, you know, 40 years, regardless of how old they are, their last 5 years are really going to have a big impact on how much they're going to get for Social Security.
Well, yeah, because typically you figure, you know, when you're in your 20s, you're not really earning that much. Mm-hmm. So if you can have, you know, 5 years counting from your 20s towards your Social Security, or 5 years counting from your 60, which would you rather have?
Yeah.
Your 60 is going to be a lot higher. So
gotcha.
It makes a big difference.
And does it then average over, though, the course of the time you've worked?
They take your top 35 years of earnings. So,
okay.
So let's say you had like a couple of zeros in there or something, and you worked to 67, and that gives you 37 years. Those extra 2 years will replace any zeros that you might have in your earnings record from when you were younger.
Oh, okay. That's great. And you said ssa.gov is where people can go to get more insight. All right.
Right. Yeah. They can go there, and you can basically, you know, create your own ID and log in and get your actual information.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. What do you need? Like your Social Security number?
Yeah, I think you need your Social Security number of date of birth. I apologize. It's been a little while since I've gone in there, but they really just walk you through the process. So having your basic information, they're going to want to verify you and make sure it's you. So,
okay. And then I know also, if you have additional questions, I believe you can schedule an appointment with a specialist, right?
Right. You can. The local Social Security offices, you can always go and schedule an appointment with one of them. You can also call in to their 800 number.
Yeah, it was funny because I went one time with a client, and I just remember I had my stainless steel water bottle and they made me take it back to my car. They wouldn't let me. And I'm like, what? And she's like, oh yeah, you can't have anything that could be of danger.
people go in there, they're not happy. And I thought that was so interesting. Like, I was like, oh my gosh. So I'm sure they've seen the gamut, but I just remember that being like, I could not believe that. Like, I could not have my water bottle in there because it was stainless steel. So how do you maximize Social Security? There's so much talk about it. Are there steps that a person can take to actually maximize their benefit?
Yeah, I think you can. Social Security has so many different ways that you can take things. And especially as a married couple, there's a lot of options for you. They changed the rules in 2015. There were a lot more loopholes at that point, but there's still some options that can really help you. You know, I think one of the things you need to look at is like, how long are you going to live? That's one of the biggest things. You know, realistically, you need to look at what your health is and think about that. Because if you're going to live a really long time, you want to push off taking Social Security as long as you can to maximize that benefit. If you don't have longevity in your family, then you might want to consider taking it earlier because you just don't have as long to take it.
Okay. Yeah. Now, help me understand if, let's say, for instance, somebody that says, okay, they're going to take it at 70, is there something they need to do at 62 when they're eligible so that they can get the maximum amount? Or is it automatic that as long as they wait until 70, they'll get the maximum benefit?
Yeah, it's automatic that if they wait till 70, they'll get the maximum benefit. You can't postpone it any longer than that. But it's interesting because like the years from your full retirement age until 70, the amount of your benefit increases 8% a year.
Yeah,
that's what the cost of living adjustment. So yeah, that's pretty significant.
That's huge. And that's what I wondered about that. If somebody needed to, you know, go and take it. Now, how does that work with a spouse? If they say they're eligible for their husbands, but then they're also eligible for theirs, is there something they need to do at a certain point to say, for instance, like take it and then defer it? And can they wait to take their spouses if that makes more sense and defer that? Or help me understand that.
Well, so those were under the old rules. You were able to do that. So basically, you could file and defer, like the husband could go ahead and claim his and then automatically postpone that benefit. Then the wife could go ahead and jump in and get her benefit with him. So they changed those rules a few years ago. So what you can do, though, is the wife can go ahead and take the benefit before her husband does. And if she's on her own benefit, that's fine. If her benefit is less than what half of his benefit would be, she also gets to bump hers up to half of his. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah. Okay. So basically, she's going to get whichever one is more.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
No, that's huge. You know, a lot of people are alarmed by the latest notification that's coming out on, I guess, their Social Security synopsis. And can you walk me kind of through that? It's kind of like, basically, we're running out of money at a certain point of time. So can you walk me through what that says? And I mean, should we all be alarmed about it? It's a little concerning.
Yeah, no, it definitely is concerning. I think people are looking at that going, you know, what the heck's going on? So
they basically are giving you a disclaimer saying we're running out of money at a certain point in time. So like, what are people going to do if that's the only thing they're relying on? It's a problem, right?
Yeah, exactly. So as of today, 2034 is the magic year that Social Security is not supposed to have any reserves left. At that point, they're saying that they're going to be able to pay $780 out of every $1,000 of benefits. And that's just based on, you know, the current workers continuing to pay into the system. That's why they're able to do that. But it just goes back to reiterating how important it is for you to have savings outside of Social Security. Even for the best option, Social Security is only going to replace about 40% of your income. And most people need more than that during retirement. So, you know, it just goes back to thinking further ahead about what you're going to do and starting to save now.
Yeah, it's kind of like, I mean, unless you want to retire broke, which I've never seen a good scenario of that. I mean, you better start thinking, right? And I mean, the bottom line in what you're saying is you better not just be relying on Social Security for your retirement.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, it's funny, you talk to clients, especially women who are widowed and divorced, and like one of their greatest fears is becoming a bag lady. And I think that when they've seen that in the past, that's mostly been people who only had Social Security to live on that found themselves in that sort of a situation. So it doesn't matter how old you are. If you haven't started saving, start saving now. Put some of your money away because you're going to need that to supplement your income in the long run. And you also don't want to have to rely on a government benefit.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, isn't that the truth? It's kind of like that's just the cherry on top that, oh, by the way, you have this extra money. Yeah, I think that's...
I know. I try to tell clients, I mean, think of Social Security as your fund. If it's there, great. If it's not, you're still going to be okay if you've planned ahead.
Mm-hmm. That's huge. Do you have any specific examples that you want to share? Like just to give people like some real world
you know, situation as far as somebody, you know, taking their benefit and kind of how that mm-hmm. would look?
I mean, yeah.
I'm kind of putting you on the spot, but I would love to hear some type of example.
Yeah, no, definitely. So like, I mean, if you run a social security calculator and you do just, everyone's going to live until 90, it's always going to tell you to wait until 70 to take any of your benefits because that will truly maximize it for you. But that's where you need to start thinking about your own situation. So let's say that there's a couple who's 62 years old and their parents have both passed in their early 70s and they've got diabetes. And so they've got some other health issues going on. For them, if they waited until 70, they might only be taking Social Security for like 2 years. So for them, it would probably make a lot of sense for them both to take Social Security at 62, just to make the most of it for their shorter life expectancy. Does that kind of make sense?
And they have a shorter life expectancy because it's just in their family. They have health issues.
Exactly. Okay. I mean, and so, you know, there's no crystal ball. So you really have to kind of look at your own situation. But like another couple, and let's say they're 62 also, they don't have any health issues and their parents are in their late 80s and doing really well. Well, chances are that they both probably have a bit longer life expectancy than the couple we talked about earlier. So it may be really lucrative for them to delay their credits until they're 67 or 70 years old, because then they're going to receive a lot more money when they get into their 90s as inflation is kind of eaten away at their assets.
Yeah. So the two biggest factors, if I hear you correctly, is number one, mm-hmm. what your kind of life expectancy is based on your health. And number mm-hmm. two, based on your family history. So
right.
if you're, yeah. Okay. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So can we switch gears to like somebody who's divorced and talk mm-hmm. about, because I mean, that has a whole different set of rules, correct?
It does.
And then if somebody is, I want to go over and I want to cover, like if they're, you know, married and they get divorced, how long have they been married? And then also what happens like if their ex-spouse is now remarried? Because there's a lot of questions and there's a lot of people that don't fully understand that.
Right. And it's interesting because I talk to some women and they're like, oh, I don't want to take his benefit because I don't want to, you know, create a problem for his current wife. And I'm like, it's okay. Social Security's got you guys both covered. So
I got to say something there. So she's so glad to be good with him. She's like, let him have the money. I'm just
kidding. I know, exactly.
I'm kidding. All you men that are listening, I'm joking, but it's just interesting how you see some partners concerned about how it impacts the other ones. The other one's like, I couldn't care less. So anyway, go ahead.
Exactly. So if you're like, once you turn 62, you're eligible for your ex-spouse's benefits. If you've been divorced for at least 2 years now, and you were married for 10 years or more.
Okay. I want to be really clear on that. So if you have been divorced for at least 2 years and you were married for at least 10 years. So if you've only been divorced for 1 year, you have to wait another year before you're eligible. Am I understanding that correct?
Yes. Well, and especially in a situation where the ex-spouse may not be taking their Social Security at that point. If they're already taking Social Security, you're eligible for it. But if they're not, you have to wait the 2 years because then you're taking it while they're not taking it.
After 2 years, even if they're not taking it, can still take it.
Exactly.
Oh, I love that. That's
great. Yeah, as long as you're 62 or older. And the other thing is too, is in a divorce situation though, you still have to be unmarried. If you remarried, you're not eligible to take your ex-spouse's benefit as a divorced person.
So is that where you say, okay, now before we get married, I want to look at Social Security benefits and make sure it makes sense?
My grandma did.
You know, it's funny. So our nanny she was our nanny from the time our kids were like babies until they were like really old. And she would never get remarried because she's like, I have such great benefits and I cannot risk losing those. I mean, you've got to look at that. I mean, from a standpoint mm-hmm. of, you know, when you're in that euphoric stage and, oh, this is going to last forever and have to, half don't. So before you make that decision, you just want to make sure that, you know, it is right. So are there other rules as far as like, if you've got to still be single to be able to collect on the benefit, is there anything else that somebody should know about getting divorced? Like if you're thinking about getting divorced, wait until you've been married for 10 years, especially if he makes more money than you or she does, vice versa, right?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that really could help you in the long run.
Is it from the time you're divorced or the time you're separated or does it matter?
You know what? Every state is different as far as what their rule is for like your exact date of divorce. So some states, it's when you separate. In Arkansas, it's the last day you had marital relations. There's all sorts of weird rules out there.
Oh, okay. Interesting. I just remember one woman that was in one of my workshops and she was married to a very wealthy person mm-hmm. and he filed for divorce like after 9.5 years so she wouldn't get Social Security. And I remember thinking, oh my gosh, and I'm assuming he probably thought that if he waited, then he would get less. Like, he didn't even need the money. But I was like, oh my gosh, that would be a horrible situation.
Yeah, so, no, that is definitely a possibility. So yeah, it depends on if it's when you file or when the divorce is finalized. So like I say, different states have different rules. So you'd have to check.
Always check with a qualified attorney or advisor. Yeah, that's good. So let's just move on a little bit to beyond just Social Security. Like, okay, we've talked about maximizing Social Security, but you know, you think, okay, the message I'm getting loud and clear is you better not just be relying on Social Security for your retirement. So what do you typically recommend a person do? And I don't know if you have like step one, step two, step three of saying, okay, you're thinking about retirement. You know, hopefully everyone listening to this is thinking about retirement, because if you're not, you need to be. So you're thinking about retirement and you're thinking like, oh, I want to have enough money. I don't want to be a bag lady. I'm not looking at, you know, this whole concept of dying broke where you're like, oh, it sounds like a great concept until you see people who have done it. And you're like, okay, not quite so exciting. Because you just don't know when you're going to die, right? And people think, oh, well, I'm not going to need as much money when I'm 70 or 80. I beg to differ. That's when you have free time. That's when you need actually more. So this whole concept that you can live on like 60% of what you're living on when you're working, I think is completely backwards. You need about 1.5 times what you need when you're working, because when you're retired, you have all this free time. I want to talk about that. What create the plan, what you need to do to create the plan so you have enough money, but also that kind of psychology of thinking you're going to need less money when I have never seen that to be the case.
And I think what I do with my clients is I spend a lot of time really talking about what they think they want their life to look like in retirement, because so many people have no idea. There are some people who they want to travel a ton more than they've done before because they haven't had the free time, like you're saying. But there's also other people that, you know, are very comfortable just staying close to home because they want to be with their grandkids and spend time like that. So once again, it goes back to everyone's situation is different. So it's really important that we understand what your expectations are for retirement and to just have you think about that, especially if you're a couple. I mean, it's like, you know, you might have different thoughts on that. So that's what I look for when I'm planning for clients, so that we can then set up their financial plan to say, you know, we want so much of a vacation budget. And it might even be, you know, we take a small vacation one year and we take a really big vacation every other year. And we work that into the plan so that we have actual numbers for you. Because I was just talking to a lady the other day. I'm like, well, you know, how much money do you think you're going to need in retirement? She's like, $100,000 a year. I'm like, why? She goes, oh, I don't know. It just sounded like a good number. So, you know, it's good to really kind of flesh that out and see what makes sense for you. And then look at what your sources of income are going to be in retirement. If you've got someone who's got a pension, they are going to feel much more comfortable spending money in retirement than someone who's taking money from their assets when they've moved from, you know, from all saving all my life to now all of a sudden I'm spending everything I've made. So
one of the things I love is guaranteed income. Like, I love it. And I find it so fascinating. And I'm actually interested in hearing what you have to say about this from a perspective of spouses. Because my husband's like, I mean, we have already a really good amount of guaranteed income. Mm-hmm. That said, I'm like, I feel comfortable even having more. And he's like, why? Because we have so much money. But I think there's a psychology with men feel differently than women. Like, I like knowing every month how much money's coming in. And that's fine that we have a lot of variable income. You know, you don't know how stocks are going to do. You don't know how the market's going to perform. But help me understand that. Do you find that women as a whole, we tend to be a little bit more conservative and be like, I want to know. I don't want to guess and say, okay, one month I have X amount and the next month I don't. So help me understand that.
Yeah, no, I would totally agree with that. I mean, because whenever I start talking about annuities, the husbands typically roll their eyes and the ladies are like, wait, so that could help replace his income when he passes? So, you know, they really do like that. When you know how much you're going to be bringing in every month, it makes it much easier for you to figure out how much you can spend and how much you should budget. And there's just not that uncertainty associated with it. So once again, looking at like everything that's above your guaranteed income, it is your fun money. You can go do whatever you want with that. And if you have more than you need, I've never heard of anyone saying that's a problem.
I know. I've got so much money in retirement, I don't know what to do. Because what people don't realize is there's always a finite number. I don't care how much money you have. There's no one in the world that can afford everything. And that's what people don't get. It's like, oh, well, if I was a billionaire, even if you're a billionaire, there's still a finite amount of what you can afford. Sure, you can afford more than a multimillionaire, but you still have a finite number. And I think some people get confused on that. But I think that's so important. Now, one of the questions, though, when it comes to what you were talking about of saying, oh, if I get an annuity, it'll replace his income. And I want to talk about when people who do have pensions are taking their benefit. And I want to talk about
taking their benefit where it's just like a larger amount only for them, or where it's for the husband and the wife. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I want to get clarity on, because this is something that I've just heard too many times in my life of saying, oh, well, when he elected or he took it, he only took it on his name. So it's just to him, and then it's going to stop when he dies. Now, I live in a community property state, but don't most states make the wife sign off on that? Or if it was assets that were earned during the marriage, or help me understand that, because I'm thinking of one person like in Arizona, and I'm like, wait a minute. He didn't elect that. He might've elected it, but you had to sign off on it because, you know, you don't have a prenup, your assets are commingled. So help me understand that, because that's so concerning to me.
Right. And the thing is that is the way that pensions used to work. The wife did not have to sign off on anything. It was just the husband. So there were so many problems with that. They've changed the rules on almost every pension plan where someone does have to sign off if it's going to be a full benefit going to the spouse. So
And when did that change? When did that rule change?
You know, I don't know if it changed as an actual rule or if companies and people that are the pension providers just realized how inequitable it was and changed it themselves. So,
okay. Because I just look at that and I'm like, I mean, like this particular one I'm thinking about, it has been like 15 or 20 years, but I'm like, mm-hmm. What? I mean, I've been doing this for 35 years, so I've been doing it a long time. I cannot ever remember in Arizona where a spouse did not have to sign off. Now, it's a community property state, but still, I think of that and I'm like, you guys, and this is meant to the women listening, you guys have to pay attention. And I realize even if you still have that kind of money belief that, you know, money's not my thing or numbers mm-hmm. aren't my thing, hopefully living in poverty isn't your thing. Because, you know, even if, let's say, for instance, you're like, well, I'm all about my family, not being able to afford to take your grandkids or your kids to dinner, not being able to go on trips, not being able to do what you want to do to be able to spend time with loved ones can have a dramatic impact on you. And if you're not, say, quote unquote, good with numbers, or you're like, well, that's not my thing, it ends up being forced to be your thing because of choices you're making. And if it's not your thing, then that's where you go and find the Susans of the world that can say, okay, it might not be your thing. Take the time to find somebody that can be their thing, somebody that knows and somebody that's going to pay attention to that to say, these are your options, these are the pros and cons, and then you can still make the final decision. But at least you go in knowing what decision you're making versus a lot of times people are like, well, I don't know. I hope it's okay. Like I have this all the time where people are like, well, we did our estate plan 5 years ago. I really have no idea how things are set up. I'm like, are you aware that you only have one trustee named? You don't even have a successor after that. Are you sure? I'm like, well, I'm reading the document. Let me read it to you. And I had another one where I had clients, we were working to get them divorced. And I said, I need your estate planning documents. Well, why? I go, it's just really important. So I come back and I'm at the meeting and I'm like, so who's Joe, you know, ABC? They're like, oh, he was a friend of ours 25 years ago. He's an alcoholic. He's been in and out of rehabs. He's like completely mentally unstable. And I go, oh, well, how would you like him being the trustee of your multi-million dollar estate plan? And both of their eyes, and they're like, that can't be true. I'm like, well, here it is. Read it. Do you see those things happen a lot when it comes to just like making sure all the areas are covered, you know, which affects your, even though we're talking about Social Security, it still affects everything about your retirement.
And especially in cases where there's blended families, that can be a big thing. I just had one of my clients, her husband passed away a couple of years ago, and they had never funded their trust. And she was so grateful because she read the trust. She goes, that's not what I want. So people just aren't aware of that. So it's really important, like every 2 or 3 years, to review your estate documents and make sure that everything still makes sense given where you are currently.
So today's bonus resource is our retirement plan checklist. You can go to themillionaireinsider.com/RPC for retirement plan checklist. You're going to love this free resource because it provides you an overview of the actions you need to take to avoid worrying about running out of money. And it's going to help you to ensure you're going to live your life and retirement on your terms. We share insights in this free retirement planning checklist resource that many people don't even think about. So again, you can go to themillionaireinsider.com/RPC to access it. One of the biggest concerns women have is becoming a bag lady. This guide was specifically designed to provide you the first step to help you create a plan so you can stop worrying about running out of money. Again, themillionaireinsider.com/RPC. You're going to love this resource.
So let's talk about funding trust. Let's dive into that because I'm in the process of reviewing one and I'm looking at all their assets and I'm like, I don't see any assets in the trust. And they're like, well, why? And I go, well, normally you fund it. So what does funding a trust mean?
So basically that is when you change the title on your assets to be in the name of the trust. That's how you fund it. So like for your example, your house, your bank accounts, your investment accounts, typically with IRAs, you can't change them because they have to stay in the name of an individual, but any other assets that you have. So
it's either owner or it's beneficiary. And then obviously right. with like qualified monies, you've got to determine if you want to leave it to your spouse and right. then your children and then the trust, or depending on what's going on in your family dynamic, it may be yes. that you're leaving it directly to the trust. And now those provisions have changed a little bit, right? Because it used to be that with an individual, you could have lifetime. Now it's basically 10 years for either a trust or an individual, if I understand correctly.
Right. Yeah. When you're a beneficiary, non-spousal beneficiary on an IRA or yeah, any sort of a retirement fund, that's the case.
Okay. That's good. But then with the wife, it's still lifetime or right. the spouse. But exactly. then you also have to take into account, can that spouse manage that, right? Because if you have a spendthrift, I mean, mm-hmm. I have a client whose spouse is such a spendthrift. It's just frightening. And I was reading an article just recently, and they were saying that people that are really good with money, like they are drawn to people who aren't. It's like yin and yang. And so, you know, if you're really good with money, the odds that you're going to marry somebody that's not is highly likely. So what do you do in that case? What do you recommend?
I mean, at that point, you can have a trust set up and have it go into a trust for your spouse.
But then is it then still over her lifetime, or then is it only for the 10 years?
Then it's only going to be for the 10 years. Yeah. But the thing is, even if they're having to take it out of the retirement account over a 10-year period, at least it's staying in the trust if it's that much of an issue. They probably take that much money out anyway.
Uh-huh. In a year. Isn't it then too that they could, since it's in a trust, wouldn't they also have the ability to then say, okay, you get a portion of it and the other portion we're going to invest somewhere else so that you have yeah. money beyond 10 years? See, those are the things that really I think are absolutely critical. And it's like, kind of like when I hear you talking about it and knowing, you know, I've done this a long time too, is it's kind of like a jigsaw puzzle, right? Like you're mm-hmm. looking at, you're saying, okay, let's look at your situation and then you're putting the pieces in. Do you see it like that?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why, you know, we were talking about Social Security earlier. That is only one really small piece of your overall puzzle. And you really have to work at putting all of that together and just make sure that the pieces fit your life.
Yeah. And so let's kind of break it down to step one, what should a person do? Step two, step three. And how would a person say, okay, I've been thinking about this. Am I doing things right? Or what should I be doing? What would you recommend from that front?
Okay. So first of all, you have to have a really good picture of what you do have already. Make sure you understand any pensions that might be there. Where are your assets? You know, how much equity you have in your home? More and more, the home is becoming part of a retirement plan versus just a cushion. Then the second thing is, if you are really a good do-it-yourselfer, there are a lot of tools out there to go on and start putting your information into calculators and put in what your goals are and try to come up with what this looks like for you. How much more do I need? Am I short? Do I have too much? What is my current situation? And the other option on that is to go and talk to a qualified financial planner who can help you work through all of that. They're really good at running different scenarios for people. So you can say, okay, if I did this, what would that look like? And then you can make a choice based on your options that you think makes the most sense for you and your family. And then the third thing is actually implementing the plan. I can't tell you how many plans I've done for people and they come back a year later and they haven't done anything. And I'm like, okay, well, let's go ahead and start again. So you really do need to implement the plan that you come up with.
Stick to itness. Okay. So number one, what do you have? So kind of like, where are you? Where mm-hmm. are your assets? Now, this is really important. How much equity in your home? So some people are like, well, what's equity? So what's equity in your home?
So the equity in your home is basically the market value less any debt that you have on the home.
So for instance, if your home's worth $400,000, you have a mortgage of $200,000, then the equity would be the $200,000. So 400 minus 200 equal 200.
Right.
And I think you hit a key point there. She said now it's becoming a much bigger part of a financial plan. And that's because housing has gone crazy. Like, I mean, if you had $2 or $3 million in real estate, you know, 2 years ago, now you have $4 or $5 million. It's gone crazy and it's going to go up and it's going to go down. But, you know, I think a lot of people, as traditional financial planners, we've always been like, exclude the home, ignore it. But now exactly. with the values of them, you really can't. And then you talked about a do-it-yourself calculator. Now, I would encourage everyone, if you have not listened to the episode on behavioral finance, themillionaireinsider.com/behavioral-finance, I encourage you to do so, because the one thing we learned from that interview is the fact that so many people make such emotional-based decisions that wreak havoc on their lives. And I will just say this much. I think the biggest advantage of working with an advisor, and I want to hear your input on this, but it's the fact that you take the emotions out of it. Mm-hmm. So like if you're dealing with my money, Susan, you do not have the same emotional attachment that I have. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, no, I totally do. I was working with someone recently and it was interesting because they think that they're going to get some money from their parents. And so they've got that put in their plan as a given. And I'm like, as advisors, we can kind of help you go, yeah, does that make sense? Or does that, you know, is that not really a good thing to put in here? So
yeah,
and taking that inheritance out of their plan, they don't look nearly as good. So it's good for them to know so that they can plan as if it's not going to happen. And if it happens, it's a good thing.
I know. We were just talking about this yesterday. I don't know how the topic came up. We were signing documents for one of my clients who's in the final stages of their life. And something came up about the fact of, you know, kids that have murdered their parents. And I'm like, oh my God, that's just horrifying. But you know, I mean, it's happened. They were bringing up like three or four different cases. And I'm like, oh my gosh. First of all, if anyone's thinking about that, I want you to let you know the odds that they're going to catch you are very high, because the first thing they do is look at the family. I don't know what goes through a person's mind, but I do think as you accumulate money, it's something you need to be aware of, you know, making sure that you have things in place that if there is any possibility that one of your children could do something to get money that, you know, you're aware of it. I mean, you hope not, but at the same time, mm-hmm. it's just, I think because it's made so much news and you hear these stories and it's just frightening. But yeah. The only other thing I want you to touch base on relating to that is mm-hmm. when there's transitions. So top of mind to thinking about one of my clients and the transition of looking at their life was they came to me when they were married. One of the spouses died. The other spouse remarried. They both had a blended family. And then that spouse died. So it was like all these different transitions. So walk mm-hmm. me through, because I think that even as I was chatting with one of my clients that's a beneficiary and also next in line as far as the trusteeship, like this is so overwhelming. There's three different trusts. Like, I don't even know what to do. Walk me through, because when you're a do-it-yourselfer, that's one thing if you're on top of it and you want to spend the 70 hours a week to stay on top of it. But what happens when something happens to that person? And let's say somebody's listening to this and, you know, they've gone through a divorce or their spouse has died. Help me understand that. And what should a person do that finds himself in that situation?
Yeah. You know, your point about talking to a financial planner is good. What I do with a lot of my clients is I make sure that I sit down with their kids so their kids know where everything is and what's going on. And sometimes that'll alleviate a lot of those issues. But, you know, a financial planner and even, you know, an estate attorney too can help you unravel where everything is and try to break it into more manageable chunks for you so that you can look at things closely and understand where they are. I think the most important thing when someone's going through a transition is to tell them to stop and just take a breath for a few minutes and let things settle. And you can help them figure out what are the things that have to be done right now and what are the decisions you can make later on so that you've got a little more time to educate yourself and get comfortable with what's in front of you.
Yeah. And one thing I would just add to that is that if, I mean, we know that we're all going to die, but if you know that that's something that could happen like sooner rather than later, start doing the plan before that person dies. It is so much cheaper and easier to have a plan in place before someone dies than it is to wait after. Would you agree with that, Susan?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
So I want to talk for 1 minute about, we have America Saves Week coming up, and this year's theme is a financially confident you. And I thought this was so timely because this was just in our paper. One of my team members brought it to me, but it's February 27th through March 3rd. And it's just a great opportunity to learn good financial habits and to assess your savings. And they recommend the same site you gave, ssa.gov, but they said /people/early-career. So for some of my audience that's younger that wants to learn about ways in which to secure your today and tomorrow, there's a great resource there. And I'd say any age, but they specifically mm-hmm. say that's also geared towards younger people so that they can start creating a plan. And the one thing I loved about this article is they said, any time is the right time to save for your future. And I thought, oh my God, I love that. And then they said, the sooner you start saving, the more your money can grow. Please share this information with someone you love. And I thought, oh my gosh, isn't that the truth? I mean, isn't that the ultimate form of really showing someone you care? Like, hey, it's time. And I think that even with this podcast, it's time, my friends. One thing I know for sure is that you either deal with money when you have the time and the choice, or you're forced to deal with it when you don't. And I've never seen a situation where a person being forced to deal with it is like a good thing. I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you. And one of the things that I always tell my clients is like, you know, you can work as long as you want to, but at some point I want that to be a choice as to whether or not you work.
Oh, yes. And with the right plan, it can be, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Exactly.
Oh, this is so good. Oh my gosh. Anything else you want to share in closing, Susan?
Yeah. You know what? Just one other thing for divorced people that I didn't get around to mentioning earlier, and I'm sorry about that. But a lot of people don't realize that if your former spouse passes away and you're 60 years or older, that you can also get their full Social Security payment once they pass.
Oh, yes.
And even if they were married to like three different people for 10 years or more, all three of them can get the full Social Security benefit from the ex-spouse. So that's just something important to remember.
Meaning if the deceased had three different spouses they were married to for 10 or more years, they can all get the full benefit.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Wow. So
yeah. And that's as long as they don't remarry before they reach age 60. So.
And then once they reach age 60, if they start taking that and then they remarry, then do they lose the benefit?
Nope.
Oh, they don't.
No. Yeah.
Not that you want to be married to somebody for 10 years just so you can get their benefit. But anyway, that's okay. I didn't realize that. Oh, this has been such a wealth of information. I want to thank you so much for your time. Now, for all of you that are loving this, you want more insight, some of you that would like to connect with Susan and learn more about what she does and how she can help you, you can go to themillionaireinsider.com/Susan-Kroger. That's K-R-O-G-E-R. Or you can go to themillionaireinsider.com/support-request. And there you can just share some insight about you and you can actually then connect with her and just a wealth of information that we have over on the site. So again, I want to thank you so much. This has been such a wealth of information and it's really clarified some of the things in my mind about Social Security that I did not know. So thanks again.
Thanks. I appreciate it.
All right. Talk to you soon. Congratulations on taking another step to create a financially free life you love. If you're not sure about your financial future or that it's in order, or you are ready to stop worrying about money or possibly the fear of becoming a bag lady, ending up broke in retirement, or you simply are ready to know your financial house is in order so that you can have a bright financial future, please go to themillionaireinsider.com/NSF. And that doesn't stand for non-sufficient funds. It stands for next step finance. It's the next best step of what you need to do so you can avoid an NSF notice in your future. Again, themillionaireinsider.com/NSF. The number of women who were not broke or poor while working or married is staggering. The entire mission of the Wealth Inside and Out podcast is to ensure you have the information for you, your family, your friends, anyone who's willing to listen to it and apply it so that you can create a financially free life you love. Again, themillionaireinsider.com/NSF. If you love the content of this podcast, please follow and subscribe to our channel so you get notified of episodes and also give us a 5-star review and share a comment. We really appreciate it. Until our next episode, take one action that will help you create a financially free life you love. I'm Annette Bau, your host. All international copyrights are reserved. Bye for now.